Billions of people just living out their lives, oblivious.
Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself.
There's something wrong.
There's something wrong.
You don't know what it is.
You don't know what
it's there. Like a splinter.
Like a splinter.
Driving you mad.
Driving you mad.
Bring the ship up to broadcast depth. We're going in. Taking Neo to see her.
See who?
The Oracle.
Welcome aboard, everybody. We're happy you could join us yet again. Let me introduce everyone for our show today. I'm James Sangster, and our co-host is Keith Davis, a fellow intellectual and seeker of truth. Our guest for today is Hamilton Morris. He's a journalist delving into such out-of-the-box topics as psychoactive substances like tryptamines and cannaboids. We also briefly discuss ayahuasca, ibogaine, and isolation tanks. Hamilton is most well known for his YouTube pharmacopoeia videos on topics like psychedelic frogs from the Amazon, cannabis, and the interesting side effects of Ambien with traumatic brain and nerve injuries. You can follow him via his Facebook account, www.facebook.com/HamiltonMorris, or his Twitter account, @HamiltonMorris.
Well, I think probably the first question I would like to ask is, Hamilton, how did you first get into, the tryptamine family, the hallucinogenic family, all of that stuff? How did you get into it in general? And then how did that lead into what you do at Vice?
Yeah, tryptamines do interest me more than any of the other classes of serotonergic psychedelics or structural classes. And part of that has to do with the fact that they have some very unusual properties that are not observed in the phenethylamines or the lysergic acid derivatives, the ergolines. One thing that I'm very interested in that isn't discussed as much with psychedelics is the possibility of them having some sort of selectivity in their effect outside of, you know, whatever psychotherapeutic effects or spiritual effects. I'm very interested in ones that might selectively target auditory perception or selectively target tactile perception or selectively target time perception, things like that. And it's very hard to find drugs that possess that kind of selectivity in their action, but you do see that in certain tryptamines.
So you're really looking at the tryptamines minutely at a very small level, exactly what they affect, and targeting that effect to a specific thing.
Yes, and they haven't been explored as thoroughly as the phenethylamines, and part of that has to do with the synthetic difficulty of a lot of the tryptamines. It's not really that it's complicated to make them necessarily as much as it is tedious to purify them. And so you see people like Alexander Shulgin, who dedicated his entire career to the synthesis of serotonergic psychedelics and really almost entirely to tryptamines and phenethylamines, spent a lot less time on the tryptamines than he did on the phenethylamines simply because they're a little bit harder to synthesize.
So he just kind of skipped over them and moved on.
He didn't skip over them. I mean, he actually dedicated a book that's probably 500 pages to them. So he certainly, that would be T-call tryptamines I've known and loved. So he certainly researched them, but not as exhaustively as he did the phenethylamines. So there are still many simple tryptamines that have not been reported in the scientific literature or seemingly have never been consumed by a human or any organism, and so there's a lot of research left to be done in that area.
I see. So your interest in that area, how did that lead you into, lead you into the column you write for Vice and the different journeys you went on with I'm sure a lot of listeners have probably seen some of your YouTube videos or the videos on Vice of you know, the frog that you went on to do the frog, as they called it, and all of those things. How did that kind of transfer over?
Yeah, well, Vice has changed a lot in the really in the last decade especially, and I think a lot of people that are currently aware of Vice don't know what it used to be like and don't know very much about its history. I think a lot of people don't even understand that Vice is a magazine. They think that it's a YouTube channel or something like that, whereas the video is relatively new, and even the website is relatively new. It used to be based on a print magazine that was read by a much smaller group of people that lived on the East Coast and in Canada primarily. And so people don't realize that it used to be a very different kind of thing. And even when I started writing for them around 2008, I guess, they didn't do video in the same way that they do now. That was certainly not the basis of the company. And they didn't have the same enormous male following. That sort of changed. It used to be read by both men and women. And it was a thing that was of interest to cool people in New York, primarily.
Well,
they were like artistic people, as opposed to like a very broad swath of males internationally.
Well, in the HBO, when they put that on HBO, it just skyrocketed, I'm sure, from there.
Right, and then it became a truly mainstream thing. Before, it was more of like a niche group of
exactly, yeah,
of like New York art and music scene people, you could say. So that was when I started writing for them, and they were always doing a lot of drug reporting, but it wasn't particularly in-depth reporting. It certainly didn't have any scientific emphasis, and so they were interested in someone that had some background in science. You know, I was actually just a sophomore in college at that point, but I was a neuroscience major, and so I convinced them to let me write these articles and eventually a column that were dedicated to psychoactive drugs and pharmacology.
So you guys went into part of the conversation that I kind of wanted to jump into. Would you consider yourself a psychonaut? And I'm not a fan of labels, but if not psychonaut, what would you consider yourself? What label would you choose?
I don't like the term. Seems almost like a journalistic term that no one would ever apply to themselves. Like
it's a
term that is great in a journalistic setting because it makes males extremely angry. So like if you write, and that's what all journalism is about getting the males angry, getting them to froth at the mouth with opinions. And if you get everyone generating opinions, then you get hits and you sell advertising. And that's what everything is about.
That's
so
true.
So what you say, you call someone a psychonaut, and then another male is sitting at home and he's depressed and he reads that and he thinks, fuck this guy, he's getting paid to do drugs, he's just a drug addict. That's not a real thing. And so it makes people angry. And so it's just a word that is meaningless and probably shouldn't be used because its only real value is to make people angry. But
that's an interesting perspective.
What would you call yourself then?
I'm just someone that studies science.
Okay.
But I have used psychedelic drugs like many people have, and I think that the word psychonaut could have meaning. It has the potential to be used meaningfully, but it's been contaminated to such an extent that it's probably better to not use it. Because if I were to use the term and I were to define it, I would make a distinction between people that are doing true experiments with unknown psychoactives. I think that's a key component.
Right.
That it's not just about taking a high dose of LSD and talking about what the visuals were like. It's not that that's necessarily bad. I'm not dismissing that, but I'm saying that that's not necessarily a true exploration. That's sort of a personal exploration, but it won't necessarily have scientific value unless you're very carefully examining the visual phenomenology or something like that. But I do think that there is true value in people that, and generally these people are chemists who have access to unknown novel psychoactives, and they consume those drugs and characterize their potency and subjective effects. And that is, I think, if you wanted to call it, you know, being a psychonaut.
So you sound like you truly sort of take the Timothy Leary LSD approach, and you're really exploring the, for the sake of exploration, you're exploring the space.
Or not even in the sense of exploration, no, really in the Shulgin sense, I would say, not so much in the Timothy Leary sense. I mean, I think that you can use these things in two different ways. One way would be, you know, and these are, obviously they both did them in sort of, they're not hard divisions between the two ways, but with Timothy Leary, it was about really using the same substance repeatedly and trying to explore its full potential and classifying all the different components of inner space or the phases of the experience, things like that. Whereas what Shulgin would do is he would often only take the substances one or two or three times after he had reached the threshold dose, and he would characterize the qualitative effects and then move on to the next thing. That was it.
Right.
If other people wanted to pick up where he left off and fill in some of the blanks or flesh out some of the details, then they could do that. But his duty was to find the threshold dose, evaluate whether or not it had some potentially toxic effects that would discourage further experimentation with the compound, and or whether it had some novel action, like a sensory selectivity or a long duration or a short duration, or who knows, or maybe enzyme inhibition or whatever. And that's what interests me. It's about not taking a known substance to explore yourself, but taking an unknown substance to explore that particular chemical and add it as a data point to the body of knowledge of what molecules can induce certain types of alterations.
That would certainly explain some of your tweets, Hamilton.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, and again, you know, there's a lot of these things. You don't necessarily need to be a chemist. A lot of these things are pushed onto the market right now as designer drugs or whatever.
That's right. There's a couple of just quick questions I wanted to ask you that actually relate to that exactly, because when I went back and watched the videos about the frog and your journey down there and all that, you mentioned just kind of as a kind of like a side note, you said, you know, you had smoked a JWH 18 laced cigarette. Now, what I wanted to ask you about that, I'm very familiar with that. I actually remember when they were selling it in the gas stations, and I actually went and found out what chemical this was, researched who created it, you know, that it was named after the roots of the man and all that good stuff. But my question was, is that something that they have over there that they're just utilizing? I mean, I didn't realize it reached that far.
No. And that's another thing that I think people don't understand is a lot of times there's very little sense of chronology on the internet, which is one problem. So people don't realize that a lot of time has passed in making these videos. That was a long time ago that I was in the Amazon. That was, that was, I don't even know, 2008, 2007. I don't remember. I think it was 21 or 22. Mm-hmm. And so that was before these things were widely available in gas stations.
Right.
And no, they certainly were not used in the Amazon. That was a pure chemical that I had brought.
I see. Okay.
And that was before it was scheduled. That was before it was widely used.
Yeah. So did you just stumble upon the research about it and then what it was? And is that kind of how you decided to explore that area?
Well, I'm friends with people that do research on cannabinoids. I knew some of the people that were involved in the development of some of those early compounds. I interviewed John W. Huffman for Vice.
Nice. Right.
Years ago. So yeah, I've followed that scene very closely for a long time. And I think that, as is the case with any unlabeled product where people don't really know what they're consuming. Mm-hmm. There have been a lot of really unfortunate adverse reactions to the compound that
have
made people think that synthetic cannabinoids are categorically dangerous, but mm-hmm. that, of course, is not the case.
Right.
It's really the issue is people consuming unmeasured quantities of unknown substances mm-hmm. without a sophisticated understanding of the risks that they
right.
may be taking.
Well, you know, on that topic, and, you know, I don't know if it annoys you when people ask you questions about, oh, man, what's the difference between this and this, you know? I'm sure you probably get that a lot, but I'm curious what the difference significantly or specifically is. In when you're talking about dimethyltryptamine, okay, you have NN-DMT and you have the 5-MeO-DMT. Now, I don't understand the difference between those two specific versions or types of DMT. Is that something that you can help me out with?
Of course, yeah. So first, the whole NN-DMT thing is a little bit confusing because people refer to DMT as NN-DMT and 5-MeO-DMT as if it's different, but 5-MeO-DMT is also NN. The N, N hyphen is specifying the position of the two methyl groups. It's dimethyl, meaning there are two methyl groups. So this is specifying that there are both of the methyl groups are located on the side chain nitrogen. There's actually two nitrogens in the tryptamine molecule, so there's even some ambiguity in the NN dimethyltryptamine name. But people will understand if you say they know that you mean on the side chain ethylamine nitrogen, not the indole nitrogen. But the difference between DMT and 5-MeO-DMT, it's better just to not even say the NN thing because it just
Confusing.
But lots of people do it. It's kind of it's not wrong necessarily. I think mm-hmm. it just confuses people. Is that then in the 5 position, which is a very important location in tryptamines, because it's also, you know, all these tryptamines bind to serotonin receptors, and serotonin is 5-hydroxytryptophan. So, sorry, 5-hydroxytryptamine rather.
Okay.
And so having that oxygen in the 5 position on the indole ring is very important for binding S5-HT2A, and you see that substitution pattern in a lot of the strongest psychedelic drugs. So 5-MeO-DMT is an example. Another would be 5-MeO-AMT. Then there's things like bufotenine that instead of having a methoxy group, have a hydroxy group, just like serotonin. Those are also very potent tryptamines. So it's just a location on the molecule that is important for serotonin binding.
So any chemist would just look at it and know exactly what that meant and dismiss it and move on. So
I mean, you know, it's worth knowing. And then it also, if you look at things like melatonin, they have melatonin is 5-methoxytryptamine, but it's N-acetylated. Mm-hmm. And that's also very close to a lot of serotonergic hallucinogenic tryptamines. But that's the chemical difference. The experiential difference is that one is a lot more potent than the other, and one is a lot less visual. So 5-MeO-DMT is more potent. It's more, I would say, it's more anxiogenic. It produces this sort of fear, an unpleasant fear response for a lot of people.
With the 5-MeO?
The 5-MeO, I would say that even though there's this whole association of DMT with death, and with and people have this idea that it's a very intense, terrifying experience, which it can be for the most part. I think it's actually a very well-tolerated drug, and that generally people have positive experiences with it as opposed to terrifying experiences, whereas 5-MeO-DMT is the opposite. I would say that the average response is not positive. It's actually an anxiogenic fear response with a lot of physiological concerns about heart rate, things like that. So
if you had someone that had the choice, you know, of one or the other that wanted to experience DMT, well, you know, obviously it sounds like you're saying you wouldn't recommend the 5-MeO off the bat.
I would say that is much more likely to cause an unpleasant, terrifying experience.
I see.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. I kind of want to switch gears a little bit here because I know you've done a lot of different things for Vice and you've touched on a lot of different topics. I mean, there's so many of them that are interesting. But I'm curious, do you come up with these things and kind of present to Vice and say, this is kind of where my interest is, this is where I want to go? Or do they make suggestions to you? How does that work?
Generally, it's my idea or it's a modification of an idea that they've had, but it's really, I'd have to say, on a case-by-case basis. There is a producer named Santiago Stelli who was more or less responsible for creating Vice video content and giving it the image that it currently has, and he's no longer with the company, but he was the producer that I worked with on all of the early projects, and we would collaborate largely. So it was usually a combination of our ideas.
I see.
For example, with the first project in the Amazon, he wanted to do something in the Amazon and asked me to list a series of stories. And then we both decided on Looking for the Frog together. That was the first. Then after that, Haiti, again, he wanted to do something on zombies in Haiti. And then I fleshed it out and incorporated chemical analysis and contacting Wade Davis and things like that. In Iceland, that was just neither of our story. That was just something that they had offered Vice. In China, that was my story, but that one hasn't come out yet. Then another thing that was his story in Peru on psychosurgery that also hasn't come out. You know, it just depends. On the most recent thing in Swaziland was I was doing four stories of my own in South Africa, and they wanted one story on weed in Swaziland. So that was actually their story, but then I incorporated the chemical analysis component.
And
they
damn
it to be about Oak Grant.
I want to see part two of that thing. I've been waiting.
Part two's out. Part two came out the same time.
Oh, did it? The part two of the gold. I'm trying to remember the exact title. You just said it.
Swazi Gold.
Swazi Gold. Yeah, the second one is out there then. Yeah. Okay. I just missed
it.
Okay, very cool. Well, I saw something that was posted, I believe, recently on YouTube, and I want to ask you how soon this happened. You were helping kind of introduce this. I believe it was a new documentary about ibogaine, and there was a man there. You were on the end, and there was like a panel of people. Do you remember that? What I'm talking about?
Yeah.
How recently was that?
Maybe a week ago.
Oh, okay. That's what I kind of figured. Well, that kind of leads into what I want to ask you, because just kind of sharing this about myself, I am someone who had bilateral tendonitis, and I was put on hydrocodones for a very long period of time, and I eventually become addicted to opiates because of that. And now I am on Suboxone, okay, just to keep me from going into withdrawals. So I've always been interested in ibogaine since I heard about it, because I know that I believe his name is Dimitri, was one of the guys on that panel with you, has like a center.
Yeah, he's great.
Yeah. I've really been looking into that. And what I wanted to know is, what kind of experiences, if any, have you had with researching or know about ibogaine? And has Vice, and I just missed it, has Vice done a story about that?
Yes, they have done a story about it. I believe it was on the HBO series. And I think I contributed an infographic to it, although I never saw the finished product. I think they may have even done multiple things on ibogaine. People like to do journalistic coverage of ibogaine because it's sort of a sensational topic. And I have never used it personally, for a number of different reasons, but of course it is a very interesting drug.
It sounds kind of scary.
Like,
you know.
Yes, it does. It does seem like it's a commitment to take it. It's not something that you
absolutely
do casually. It's also very expensive, so I think the number of people that would do it casually is limited. But
kind of spot, yeah, it's kind of a little. I have to save a little bit, you know, to be able to afford it.
Yeah, my main worry with all of this, and this is also having to do with the ayahuasca popularity that's going on right now, is that these things, you know, people want to present them as sacraments to say that they operate outside of some capitalist system, that this is not a drug, it's a medicine. They have all these things that have sort of become cliches, in my opinion. And the problem is when you uncritically accept those ideas, you open yourself up to being exploited in a really serious way.
That is
and
very
after
true.
That screen, and I try to tone it down because I don't want to be, you know, people really love this stuff. A lot of people who are atheists or who don't believe in organized religion find some kind of religion or spirituality in these substances, and for those people to criticize the tradition that they see as their spiritual framework, it makes them very offended. And I don't have any real desire to get into it with people. It's not a subject that interests me all that much. But I will say that a lot of the things that these people are worshiping, that they believe are ancient, ahistoric rituals, are actually either complete fabrications or constructions made for tourists. Right. Or at the very best, they're not really ancient.
So what you're saying is all the stuff that they go into as far as the traditional, the tobacco blowing, the singing, and all this stuff isn't really necessary. It's something that they've just kind of adopted doing.
Yes, and I think that some of it may be ancient, some of it may not be. It's really it's hard to say.
Discern the difference.
You know,
right.
they're using it in a very different cultural framework than we live in for different reasons than we use. So I think there's this idea that this is an ancient, primitive spirituality that we are gaining some privileged access to, and this is a very different thing.
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
But the truth is that these things were not necessarily used in the spiritual sense that people believe that they were. They're actually, if you look at the anthropological literature, people like Dobkin de Rios, who studied these things extensively in the 70s, you find they were using things like ayahuasca more as a diagnostic tool than as some kind of spiritual catalyst. So the idea would be that you feel some kind of bodily or psychological illness, and you go to the shaman, and the shaman takes ayahuasca with you, and they diagnose the nature of the illness. Maybe you were cursed by a witch, and there's a spiritual thorn stuck in your liver, and then the shaman will extract using whatever magical technique. So you know, these things are used medically and diagnostically, and of course that isn't going to really work for most people that have any materialist leanings in medicine, that believe in conventional Western medicine, because you know that the problem isn't a spiritual thorn. So they've retooled it to something that's a little bit more palatable for tourists, and I think that's part of it. The other thing is that a lot of people are, and I don't talk about this publicly often, but I've been contacted privately by women who have been sexually abused by these shamans.
Oh, I wondered if that probably was going on somewhere. I saw the potential for that possibility.
Yes, no, it most certainly is happening. So you have the men that stand up and write their books about their how they started out as a cynical this or that, and then they were softened by the ancient tradition, and this is the great spirituality, and this is going to save the environment and save mankind. And the actual result is that you have all these credulous people who don't understand that this material is a tea that could be prepared in an apartment without any guidance or assistance. It is a tea, period, nothing more than that. It is plants that are brewed in hot water, and the tea is consumed. They believe that they cannot make this tea for whatever reason. They are prepared to take LSD, prepared to take mushrooms, prepared to take any drug,
man.
But for whatever reason, this tea is completely different.
Yeah.
It's all dose dependent. I mean, you can take it at a dose that is threshold, or you can take it at a very high dose. And if you take it at a high dose, maybe it's good to have a friend watch you while you're under the influence of it.
Well,
but I don't think that means that you need to pay for a plane ticket to Peru.
You're
to
right.
Sit in a room full of strangers and to potentially be exploited or abused by a stranger just because someone told you that's the way it has to be done, because they bought into something that very well may be superstition or a fabricated tradition in order to profit.
Well, now let me ask you a quick question, because I think I know the answer. Do you feel that this carries over to Ibogaine treatment as well, or is that a different animal?
I hate to get into the specifics here, because this is so many people are financially invested in this now, and those are the same people that are going to attack me.
You're right.
For criticizing. It's become a big, very profitable thing. I will say that ibogaine, without question, has had a therapeutic effect for people who are opioid dependent and opiate mm-hmm. dependent, and that that potential exists. I will also say that I know for a fact that some of these clinics are run by people who are potentially not using them in a capacity that's going to have a real therapeutic effect on people, well, and that you have to be very careful.
And here's my last question on this topic. Now, me personally, and I'm not asking you for any, you know, tell me what to do or anything, but in me personally, as someone that just wants to get the benefit of what the actual alkaloids can do, which is eliminate my opioid dependency, would you recommend in general someone like that to go to a clinic or to research it themselves? Do you believe a person is capable of doing that themselves, or does that require?
I absolutely believe, assuming that you are of average intelligence and competence in most things, that anyone is capable of doing, as long as they actually put in the time and do the research, that they are capable of, at the very least, coming to an informed conclusion about whether or not they are prepared to self-administer the material or whether they are going to require external guidance. I think that at the very least, you have to give yourself enough credit to assume the possibility that maybe you could do these things on your own, and maybe that would be the most beneficial. And one thing that I do worry about, and this doesn't just hold true for shamanism, I think it holds true for psychiatry as well, is I remember seeing a psychiatrist when I was in high school and always thinking, you know, maybe this person knows something I don't know. Maybe they know about some drug, some pharmaceutical, some treatment, some method that will make everything less difficult for me. I won't have ADHD anymore. Everything will suddenly be easier if they just introduce this pharmaceutical I haven't heard of. And then eventually I started to realize that that I knew about all the same pharmaceuticals they knew about, that I knew the arsenal of tools that they were working with, and that none of them were going to be magic bullets, and that if I wanted a solution, I had to figure it out on my own. And I think that people are have that same delusional hope in shamanism. Right. Maybe the shaman knows something that they don't know. Maybe they have a technique or some kind of magical tool that is going to fix everything. And I think that it's a bad attitude to have.
Yeah, I heard a phrase a long time ago by a man named Ken Roberts, who teaches an amazing, totally off the off topic here, but he teaches an amazing course on commodities. But he had this phrase. He said, "No one knows what you think they know." And I believe that holds true in a lot of situations.
Yeah. Absolutely.
To follow up on what you're talking about, Hamilton, I completely agree, and it's been my experience in going to the doctor in for specific conditions. You know, they were classically trained in information that's 20 years old. In many, many, many cases, if you do your homework and you know how to do any amount of research whatsoever, you walk in there knowing more than they do. You don't have the perspective they do, but you know more about the specifics of the treatments. I think that's the case all across the board these days.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm not, you know, again, I'm not suggesting that the doctors are stupid or that they should be distrusted. That's not the case at all. I have a lot of respect for Western medicine, and I actually do believe that people are increasingly skeptical of pharmaceuticals in general, and a lot of that is deserved, but I don't think that you can categorically dismiss the therapeutic potential of all pharmaceutical products at all. I think that a lot of these drugs do help people. So even antidepressants, as stigmatized as they are. So that is all to say people just should really do as much research as they can and shouldn't assume that just because something is quote traditional or quote ancient, that it is traditional and that it is ancient and that any of these people should be trusted. I don't know if you're familiar, there was actually a death very recently, in addition to these reports of sexual abuse, someone died as well, and his body was secretly buried by the shaman. And when his parents asked where he'd gone, you know, the shaman said that he didn't know, but he'd actually buried the body secretly. This was all over the news internationally. It's a really bad thing. And then,
what country did this happen in?
In Peru. The person's name is Kyle Nolan. And if you look, if you look at what happened, the most, I mean, it's very scary that this happened, but what the most scary thing about the entire story is that after this death, and I think the shaman's name was Master Munculto or something like that, after his death, all of these people started coming forward and saying, oh, well, you know, come to think of it, I also had an experience with Master Munculto, and he told me that he was from Mars and said that he was, you know, 125th generation shaman, but then he left me in the woods in the middle of the night or in the jungle in the middle of the night to go watch soap operas, and it seemed like a really dangerous thing to have done, but I thought that was tradition and I didn't want to criticize it. So that's the other thing, is we rid ourselves of our critical ability. If you come as an outsider to this, what you believe is a venerated ancient tradition, you're afraid of saying something critical because you don't want to look racist, you don't want to look insensitive.
Or you think maybe they know something, like you said, they know something I don't know, so I just need to do what they tell me, you know?
Sure, exactly, yes, that's another possibility. So there's a lot of reasons that people will strip themselves of common sense, of just their normal critical abilities, and accept things that should be evidently dangerous, because they're putting false confidence in these people that are just being sold to them, and are profiting off of the whole deal. When you can order these things on the internet and do them in your apartment if you want, or your house or wherever, with your friends, listening to whatever music you want, or in whatever environment that you think is best for the experience. The truth is that these experiences are very complicated, and everyone is looking for some sort of interpretive framework that allows them to make them less complicated.
Right.
And I don't think that's a good thing to do.
Right.
I think that you have to accept the complexity, and as difficult as that may be, you have to come to terms with these things on your own.
So I think
you want to benefit maximally.
I think I just figured out a great business opportunity for the three of us. You know how they have the websites for Rate Your Professor, and you can go, you know, find out the details about your professor you're taking at a college campus. We need a Rate Your Shaman, so people can go on and document their experiences with their shaman. And you don't hook up with the shaman unless they have a 5-star or better rating.
Well, like Dimitri, I've done a lot of research on him. That man knows what he's talking about. I've seen him on old interviews with Sarah Glatt, who runs a center over in Amsterdam, or Rotterdam it might be. I don't remember exactly. But, so there are legit people out there like that.
Well, absolutely, absolutely. And I agree. He strikes me as a very honest, very unpretentious, very smart person, and
we're back. Okay.
Sorry about that.
You were I don't know how long you talked, man, but I had just asked you the question or said something about Dimitri, and you were coming and saying, yeah, you believe he's legit, and we lost you.
Oh, yeah, it's fine, yeah. But again, I don't even really, you know, people love talking about shamanism, and that's fine. It's actually one of the areas I think it's important because of the potential for people being either exploited financially or sexually.
Absolutely.
Or just manipulated and sold into what may or may not be a false tradition. But the truth is that, you know, the people are so religiously protective of this dogma that I don't even like talking about it publicly. I really prefer to talk about chemistry and pharmacology because it's a more rational area to discuss. People are less opinionated and passionate about, or they're very passionate about it, but they're passionate about it in a logical way. And so every time I speak publicly about this, I then get a bunch of emails, and it just, after a while, it's not even in the same way that I am an atheist, but I'm not going to talk about it all day or get into arguments with the religious people about
nobody wins those discussions.
So that it's not really something that, you know, my interest is in chemistry, pharmacology, the history of these substances, things like that, anthropology to a lesser extent, and not so much in current shamanic traditions,
right,
or rituals or techniques.
That kind of, I don't know how that got on this other thought I had, but you did something, and I don't know how recent this was, on the flotation tanks, where you went in the sensory deprivation tanks, which is something that I've done a lot of research on but have yet to experience. I'm going to take care of that soon, but how would you rate an experience like that with any other drug that you've taken, is it really, does it really significantly impact you the way most of the YouTube videos people make it out to?
It's certainly worth doing. I think that the degree of impact is entirely dependent on the person doing it and how disciplined they are mentally. I would say that for someone who has practiced meditation in the past and have a lot of mental self-control, they could probably go a lot deeper and have a more profound experience than someone who drinks a ton of coffee and has terrible ADHD and is very undisciplined mentally, because you can have a full spectrum of experiences. There's not any one thing that will reliably happen. You could sit feeling completely bored and impatient and or even claustrophobic the entire time and never have a moment of bodily transcendence or anything like that. Or you could have a profoundly spiritual experience, I suppose. I would say I fell somewhere in between. The other thing is that, like meditation, I think that maximally really being able to fully take advantage of the experience is something that probably takes a bit of practice, which is easy to do if you just have to sit on a mat in your apartment, but not as easy to do if you're spending $40 an hour and have to drive to the center and have a timer. So maybe in order to get that, in fact, I'm almost certain, in order to get the best results of these things, you probably would have to own a tank. You would have to use it frequently, and you'd have to really, really discipline yourself. That said, I think a shortcut is probably to do it while you're stoned, because that already gets you into a state, a more meditative, creatively open state where you can transcend into those sorts of dream areas more easily.
Well, I remember a story Joe Rogan was telling that I don't remember who the man was, but I believe he was getting into the flotation tank for the first time, and if I'm not mistaken, it was Timothy Leary's tank he was getting into. And someone had asked him, "Do you want the normal dose?" And he's like, "Sure." And he didn't even know what they're talking about, and they threw ketamine in him. And he got in there, his first experience in a flotation tank with some ketamine in his system, and it really had a profound impact on him, to say the least. But that was a pretty a pretty wild story there.
Yes, I'm sure. I'm sure. Yeah, and there's a lot of different ways that it could be used. Yeah, I mean, it could be used. It's a tank of water, so it could be used in every way a tank
That's
of
right.
water could be used.
Yeah,
You could,
exactly.
if you are sore from playing sports, I'm sure it could have a therapeutic effect on
Sure.
muscle tension, because it's very relaxing. I'm sure it would help with anxiety. I'm sure it would help with a wide variety of different things. So whenever I see someone posting like, "Oh, nothing happened, it's bullshit, it's totally fake," it's irritating to me, because
Yeah, they
these
had
people obviously went in with
an expectation.
a false idea of what had to be done, and with very little, and thinking that they didn't have to put in any effort to get results. Well, it's not LSD, it's not a psychedelic drug in and of itself. It won't do the work for you. It won't just take you there immediately. So I guess ideally make friends with someone that owns a center, or buy your own tank, because it will probably take a little while to get to a level where you're achieving the maximal benefit.
It was funny. I was telling my friend James yesterday, I think it was. I was at a place where there was a very dark room, and I just went in that room and shut the light off, and just deprived myself of just visual, anything visual, without having to close my eyes. And just that alone was relaxing. Just things like that that people don't think of it. Whatever you can use to easily relax will help.
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
There's some, I just got to ask you this. How big of a fan were you of Joe Rogan's podcast before you went on? Had you heard about it before, or was it just, how did you end up getting on his podcast? Which that was a great episode, by the way.
I had never heard it before, and I haven't really heard it very much since. I didn't realize, I like grew up watching news radio and things like that, so I and Fear Factor, so I knew of Joe Rogan on that celebrity level, but didn't know about him on the like cult leader of legions of male Redditors level. And so I profoundly underestimated you know, what seemed like at the time just seemed like, oh, this will be a fun, because I was going to do the episode with Joe Rogan. It was really more about filming in Joe Rogan's sensory deprivation
tank than
it was about doing the podcast. He asked me to do the podcast. It was all for a Vice shoot. It wasn't necessarily for the podcast at all. That was just a side thing that he'd asked me to do.
Right.
And then we ended up getting extremely stoned, and it's something people are still talking about and emailing me about, and something that I really had not even considered. I mean, now I think if I go on it again, which I hope to do at some point in the future when I'm next in LA, you know, I guess I have a better understanding of the dynamic and what sorts of things go on there. But when I was there, I really just had no idea what,
didn't know
about Brian Redband,
he's on a bunch of different podcasts also, yeah. Which has a whole different side group of following. So what did anything happen after that you weren't expecting, as far as, like, did you start getting inundated with emails? Did people find your personal phone number, anything like that crazy?
I think I got 2,000 Twitter followers that day. it was something that a lot of people responded to. The magnitude of the response is something that I had not predicted at all. Joe Rogan is a very powerful person in a way that I didn't fully understand. I guess I was always looking at him on more of a level of like, how, like, this guy's really like interesting and that he's kind of a celebrity, but he's also so open about his own life and is very just generally open-minded about everything, and he's just an interesting guy. I didn't realize that he was taken, that so many people really considered him like a leader, you could
say.
And not that I don't think that. I think that's great. I really think he's a very funny and a very rare personality. So, yeah, I've...
Something, Tyler, that I thought was cool is I was already a fan of Joe Rogan's. I had been listening to his podcast, and I was a fan of yours. I had been watching your stuff and what you were doing for Vice, and then I heard Hamilton Morris is going to be on the Joe Rogan podcast. I'm like, yes, it's about time.
Yeah, you know? That's the best of both worlds. That's two superpowers coming together.
Exactly.
I'm definitely going to, if and when I do that again, I mean, I have a more defined agenda for what I'm talking about, because I probably would not be stoned.
Right. I don't know how you're going to work that out, man.
He'd have you back on in a heartbeat, man. You guys are two birds of the same feather, without a doubt.
Go on with Joey, man. He'll feed you a cookie or some shit, and you'll be... Well, do you have anything that you can talk about that's coming up that you're working on for the future? Or that you want to plug?
Sure. When we were in, I think a lot of people thought, well, why didn't you finish the chemical analysis in Swaziland, which is what's featured in the second part? And the reason that the chemical analysis was never done is, first of all, Vice had no interest in that. They didn't really want to facilitate any aspect of the analysis to begin with. And so we wanted to have the tickets extended so that we could do the analysis. They were not especially sympathetic.
right.
But the other thing is that, you know, they want to be very efficient. It's not cheap. Mm-hmm. Even on an extremely low budget, it's not cheap to do something like to go to Africa. So they don't, you know, they don't send you to Africa to do one story.
Or the Iceland thing that you really looked very bummed about. the Iceland.
Oh, well, that was just ridiculous. I mean, that was a little bit more, that was more old. They used to have more of a, I guess they used to just manage their money a little bit differently, you could say. And also I was very good friends with the creative director of the company. So everything was loose. You know, we went to China and did a whole piece in synthetic cannabinoid laboratories. It was never even released. Things like that. You know, then that was a whole trip to China that was just nothing even came out of it. But now it's not like that anymore. Now if they're buying the tickets, you have to come back with a half dozen stories. And
a guy like me that's a fan would still love to see that. You know, I'm just saying, there's people out there that would still love to see it if they made it available. People would watch it.
Yeah, but you know, it's also, people don't realize that it's then the post production is also very expensive. You have to
have an editor
that is going to work on it for weeks and weeks. You have to, if you use any music that isn't essentially scratch music that they get from a company called Jingle Punks, then you have to pay $2,000 a song. If you have any graphics done, that's additional cost. So things are even
this is
all very low budget. Even at the low budget, cutting every imaginable corner level, these things still end up costing, you know, tens of thousands of dollars. So yes, when we were in Africa, we shot five stories. One is Swazi Gold. The other is the ambient piece that preceded it, which people, I don't think
the ambient
noticed
effect.
That part of that was, that actually shot in South Africa.
That was a great story,
great
piece.
That was amazing. I loved that.
Yeah, it's really an interesting idea. So there's that, and then we have another piece coming out. It's about half done on a antiretroviral drug that's used to treat HIV internationally, but especially in South Africa, that also has a unanticipated psychedelic effect. So this is going to be. It's really interesting, actually. We're incorporating some original scientific research. So at the lab that I work at in Philadelphia, we actually did a thermal decomposition experiment because people exclusively smoke this drug, but no one has ever looked to see what happens when it's smoked. A lot of drugs are chemically transformed when they are smoked.
Right.
So we built a mechanical smoking apparatus with a vacuum pump that drew the burning antiretroviral drug through a series of cold traps, and then we collected the smoke fractions and chemically analyzed them to see if there was a change in the drug, and there was. So,
oh, wow.
So who even knows how that modulates the experience? And a lot of times that is the case, that even if the whatever, like, decomposition product or metabolite doesn't have the same activity, it can modulate the activity in all kinds of unanticipated ways. Like PCP, you know, PCP has this activity on a certain subtype of glutamate receptor, but in the synthesis you go through an intermediate called PCC that has what a chemist would call a nitrile group, but it's essentially like a cyanide
like a derivative
molecule bound to the molecule, so when you heat it up it actually releases cyanides. You have this dual effect of the PCP effect, and then you also have what is essentially a cyanide prodrug, and the two create a very complex cocktail pharmacologically. And the same is likely true for this drug, efavirenz, that we were looking at in South Africa. So that's the next piece that's going to come out in maybe a month. And after that, we have a really big piece on quaaludes in South Africa. And how that is connected to the chemical and biological weapon research program. So there's going to be some really interesting stuff coming out soon. Mm-hmm. And that aside, just I have a book that is going to be coming out. It's the manuscript is due in October of this year. It's being published by McSweeney's, which is a California-based publisher, and it's an expansion of a piece that I wrote for Harper's Magazine, because I actually don't write for Vice anymore.
You don't have your piece? You just do videos for Vice? Okay.
Yeah.
So what is the title of the book? Or has there been
It's tentatively called Bloodspore, which is the name of the article on Harper's, which is actually available. Most Harper's articles you have to have a subscription for, but you can read this free online. It's called Bloodspore, and it's about the unsolved murder of a doctor and mushroom researcher in Texas in the 80s.
Oh, wow. That's going to be interesting for me because I live in Texas, and very cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I did all the research in San Antonio, so it's an interesting story. And then Harper's has a very different audience than Vice, so it's not, I guess, the overlap between those two sides of things. There's not very much of it, but...
Right.
But yeah, so if you read that and you're interested, then there will be a greatly expanded form of it coming out.
Nice. October this year. Okay. Hey, we only got a couple of minutes. If you are you needing to go right at the hour?
pretty soon. I mean, if there's anything else.
Well, mainly.
Really need to.
Yeah. Do you have anything else that you want to plug while we're at it?
No, I think that's pretty much. Oh, and then I also, if anyone cares about scientific literature, I have a big review article in the journal Drug Testing and Analysis that's on the history of associated anesthetic drugs internationally. That it's a scientific article that it should be of interest to anyone that cares about PCP and ketamine and those sorts of things.
I'll tell you what, and if you will email us any links to anything you have, we'll make sure and put it in the footnotes in the description of the video so everybody can check it out. I thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us, and we will be glad to have you back anytime anytime you want.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Thanks for having me.
Cool, man.
And email me the link when you've got it all together.
Okay, yeah, it'll probably take us a week or so. Yeah, you're one of those open-minded, non-judgmental, super intellectual, interesting people to talk to. So we could just burn hours discussing the meaning of string, you know, whatever it is.
Well, good. I'm glad it was good for you all. And yeah,
absolutely.
Thanks for having me.
That concludes this episode of Higher Consciousness Radio. We want to give a special long overdue thanks to Bill Curd and his musical talents for contributing his time and effort into mixing our custom intro music, which I absolutely love. You guys wouldn't believe how many rounds of edits it took to make that happen. So I've been meaning to give him a shout out on this project for a while. If you guys dig his work, and I think our intro music is absolutely phenomenal. If you dig his work and you want to check out what he's doing and what projects he's got going on, you can visit Bill over at his website, curdmusic.com, curdmusic.com. Thanks, Bill. We really appreciate it, and thanks to everybody for listening.